Today I'm glad to introduce you Professor Jiamin Jing from University of Illinois. So Jiamin Jing is a YT Law Chair Professor in Electrical and Computer Engineering and Director of the Electromagnetics Laboratory and Center for Computational Electromagnetics at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. He has authored and co-authored over 275 papers in referred journals and over 20 book chapters. He has also authored the finite element method in electromagnetics, electromagnetic analysis and design in magnetic resonance imaging, and theory of computational electromagnetic fields, and co-authored computational special functions, finite element analysis of atoms and arrays, and fast and efficient algorithms in computational electromagnetics. And some of these books are already we are giving to our undergraduate and graduate courses. So his name often appeared in the University of Illinois list of excellent instructors. He was elected by ICA among world's most cited authors in 2002. He's a fellow of IEEE, ACES, and Electromagnetics Academy. Recently, he received 214 ACES Technical Achievement Award, IEEE ATS Champion Title Distinguished Educator Award, and ACES Computational Electromagnetic Award, and ATS Harrington Inter Computational Electromagnetic Award. So I'm glad to I have been able to finish this together. Thank you very much for coming.
Okay, good afternoon. It's really, truly a great pleasure to visit this beautiful country and to have opportunity to visit your university, to meet some old friends and get to new some new friends, right? And for that, I want to thank Professor Otto for the invitation. Okay, so today, I'm going to talk about the fascinating world of computational electromagnetics, the past, present, and the future. And this talk was actually intended for undergraduate students, and my intention was to attract more undergraduate students to the area of electromagnetics. But when I look down, most of you are probably graduate students and some are faculty members. I don't know if there are any undergraduate students here, right? But it's okay, there are two, three, okay, there are a few, okay, that's good, So I'm not going to change my talk, and if most of material look very familiar to you, take it as for your future use to attract undergraduate students to this fascinating field, right? Okay. So let me start with a story which says many years ago, a musician, a physics professor, and a college student was sentenced to death. And before execution, the judge asked them for their last wish. And the musician said, music is my life, and for my entire life I play the music, and my last wish is to have a violin to play my favorite music. And the judge said, no problem, the request is granted. Then the college professor said, I'm a poor, boring physics professor, and my entire life I taught electromagnetics, so my last wish is to give a lecture on Maxwell equations. And judge said, okay, that's reasonable request. So the request is granted as well. And he turned to the student and said, young man, what's your last wish? And the student looked at the judge and said, your honor, my last wish is to get executed before professor gave a lecture on electromagnetics, right? And although it's a joke, it reflects some of the reality today. And the reality is in the field of electronic and electrical engineering, electromagnetics is not a popular attractive element, right? And this situation not only exists in US but also around the entire world, in Europe and Asia, right? And in US we get most EM graduate students from three countries, Greece, Turkey, and China, because somewhat, students in these three countries still pay attention to fundamentals, and they are still, better trained in mathematics, right? But when you ask students why you don't like electromagnetics, you know. Many students would answer that electromagnetics is very, very old subject. And it's, you know, very theoretical and abstract. And they don't see the relevance of electromagnetics to today's technology, right? So is electromagnetics very old? Actually, it is. Because almost 200 years ago, Ampère discovered Ampère's law, that a current can produce magnetic field, right? And then 5 years later, Faraday published his discovery, which shows that in a loop, the change of magnetic flux can induce voltage inside the loop, right? Okay. And when Maxwell put this discovery into a mathematical equation, okay, and it shows beautifully how the change of magnetic field produces electric field. And this Faraday's law is so fundamental and so beautiful that a physics professor in Canada, Walter Smith, wrote a song on Faraday's law, and the title is Physics Utopia. And it starts in Faraday's law of induction, the law of all sea and land, no lie, no deceit, no corruption, in this law, so complete and so grand. Then he described this law, and anyways, it's Faraday's law of induction that allows us to generate power. It gives 40 increase or deduction. We could sing on and on for an hour, right? And this shows the important application of Faraday's law, right? And around the same time, Gauss discovered Gauss' law, which relates electric field to the charge in the space, right? Okay. And as I said, Maxwell was a genius in mathematics, and he was able to, you know, convert the physical description into mathematical expression. And when he converted Faraday's law and Ampère's law into mathematical form, and examined Ampère's law, and he found that Ampère's law is no longer valid in a capacitor with alternating current. Okay? And to fix this problem, he introduced a new term, which is called the displacement current. And this new term is very similar to the term in the Faraday's law. And with the displacement current, okay, the electric field and the magnetic field are fully coupled. Okay? And use his mathematical skill, he derived the equation governing electric field and magnetic field, and he found these two equations are wave equations, which pretty much say that the electric and the magnetic field can propagate in the space. And that led to his first prediction that the electromagnetic field can propagate, right? And then he calculated the speed of propagation, and he found that the speed is very close to the speed of light. And that led to his second prediction that light is a special form of electromagnetic field, right? And both predictions were experimentally verified by Heinrich Hertz a few years later, right? And the same professor wrote a song on Ampère's law, titled Two Great Guys, One Great Law, right? And Mr. Ampère's magic, mystical, wonderful law of Maxwell equations is the longest and the strangest of all. So he described this law and the problem Maxwell discovered and how he fixed the problem, right? And so to Maxwell, the mystery was revealed. He saw how light could move through empty space. The changing B field made changing E field, and vice versa, all at a perfect pace, right? So before electric and magnetic field are coupled, right? They are considered to be separate, living with a very boring life, and with displacement current, now they can propagate together, dancing on the wing of each other, right? Okay, so these form today's so-called Maxwell equations. Okay, and using factor identities and integral theorems, we can convert these Maxwell equations into a differential form, right? And these were published about 150 years ago, right? So true, electromagnetic theory is quite old, at least 150 years old, right? Okay. However, we know that these equations cover all the electromagnetic phenomena. And all electromagnetic phenomena exist in our daily life in a variety of technologies, right? So we know that these Max equations are actually very, very important, okay? They are really the foundation of the entire electrical and electronic engineering, okay? And not only they are important, these Max equations have a huge predictive power in the sense that if you know how to solve these equations, okay, then you can predict the performance of your design without even going to the lab and build up your design, right? Okay, so, and also with the solution of these equations, okay, we can understand electromagnetic phenomena much, much better, okay? Because these equations are not only valid at low frequency, they are valid all the way to optical frequency. And they are also valid on all length scale, from subatomic length scale to intergalactic length scale, right? So if we know how to solve these equations, we can make huge use of these equations in today's technology development. Okay, that's great news. But very unfortunately, you know, all of us know that today, even today, after 150 years, right, we can only solve these equations for a handful, very, very simple cases. Okay, so for past 150 years, okay, we can only solve these equations for practical application in approximate sense, right? Such as at very low frequency, you know, we approximate Max equations at cutoff current law and voltage law. And at very high frequency, we approximate Max equations in terms of geometrical optics or physical optics, right? But for the vast majority of practical engineering problems, okay, we don't know how to solve these equations. Okay? But then very fortunately, during past 50 years, with the development of computer technology and all the numerical methods, now we know we can solve these equations on the computer in a numeric sense. Okay? So now let's take a look at how can we solve Max equations on a computer. So suppose we have a problem to design a filter in a rectangular waveguide. And this filter can be designed simply by insert a bunch of conducting strips across the waveguide. And the question is how to choose the separations and the width of these strips to produce desired response, right? And for such a relatively simple problem, we all know that there's no way to solve it analytically. To use a computer to solve this problem, we first start from a physical description, right? A waveguide with a bunch of conducting strips. And since in this problem, there are infinite number of points, and the computer cannot handle infinite number of points, right? So we first need to sample the continuous field at a bunch of discrete points, finite number of discrete points, right? And then to find the field at any other points, we can connect these discrete points to form a so-called triangular mesh, okay? And then within each triangular element, okay, we can use the interpolation method, right, to interpret the function, okay, in terms of three points of the triangle, right? And with this interpolation, then at any point in this solution domain, we have expression for the field with discrete points as our unknown value. And with this interpolation of the field, then we can convert Maxwell's equation into a set of linear algebraic equations. Okay? And when we solve this set of linear algebraic equations, we get field values at these discrete points and go back to the interpolation and we found the field everywhere else. Right? And this shows the entire process to use the numeric methods to solve Maxwell equations on a computer. Okay? And with that, you know, we can compute the field distribution, and then based on the field distribution, we can compute the reflection coefficient or transmission coefficient, right? And from this example, we see few things, right? One thing is that, hey, you know, this numeric method is very useful, very versatile, in the sense that it can be applied to many different complicated problems, right? So most, you know, practical problems can be handled using numerical methods, right? And second, right, with a numerical solution, okay, we can visualize electromagnetic field, right? And the one thing that turns students away from electromagnetic theory is the problem that our human eyes cannot see electromagnetic field, right? Although this room is full of electromagnetic wave, but we cannot see it, right? And when you cannot see it, you feel it's abstract and you don't like it, right? And with numerical simulation, we can see how the field look like and how the field propagate, right? And the third thing is that this computation, this simulation is very fast, right? For this kind of simulation, it takes a couple of seconds to get the solution. And with this fast solution, okay, we can systematically optimize the design, which is completely impossible if we want to design this filter in the lab, right? Think about each iteration, which may cost a couple of days, right? So if you want to examine hundreds of iterations, it may take a couple of years to arrive at the final optimized design. But with computer simulations, okay, we can fully optimize design with a matter of a couple of hours. Okay? And also with this fast simulation, right, we can understand the physics involved in this device much better. Okay? So this simple numerical example shows the power of numerical method in solving Maxwell equations, right? Okay. And what you see is actually nothing but the finite element method, one of the basic numerical methods for solving Maxwell equations. Okay? And if we look at the entire process, we can say that the entire computational electromagnetic process involves few steps. It starts from a physical problem, and then convert a physical problem into a mathematical description, right? And based on the mathematical description, we develop a numerical method and perform discretization and program numerical method into computer codes and computer, you know, electromagnetic field in the solution domain. And based on the electromagnetic field computed, then we can extract physical parameters. The process called post-processing. Okay, so this flowchart shows the entire computational electromagnetic process. And if we look at this entire process, we realize that computational electromagnetics is really an interdisciplinary field, right? It requires knowledge at least in three fields. One is electromagnetic physics, right? And another one is mathematics, especially linear algebra, because most numerical methods at the end, okay, have to solve a set of linear algebraic equations. Okay? And then it also involves computational science, because we need to convert medical methods into a simulation software so that people can utilize for their daily use. Right? Okay. Now, as I mentioned, electromagnetic phenomena are involved in many technologies. So as a result, okay, if we have ability to solve Maxwell equation numerically on computer, we can impact many, many technology fields, right? Starting from the RCS analysis for the defense applications such as automatic target regulation and stealth technology, right? To antenna analysis design, EMC, EMI analysis, to remote sensing, subsurface sensing, non-destructive evaluation, to microwave engineering and MEMS, to the optics involving lasers and optoelectronics, to the computer chip design, right? To the physics-based signal and image processing, to biomedical engineering and biotechnology, and all the way to very well-known wireless communication and propagation, right? And this is just a sublist of application of computational EM. And I have this list here because in various stages of my life, I worked on some of these problems. And actually, one big item missing here is electro-machine design, because that is also a very important area that requires numerical simulation. All right? Okay. So next, let's spend a few minutes to take a look at some of these applications, okay? The earliest application of computational EM is for the defense application, right? And a typical application is to evaluate radar scatter. And we know that given target, when the electromagnetic wave is incident upon the target, the electromagnetic wave will induce the currents on the target or inside the target, and this induced current will produce another new electromagnetic wave, and that's a scattered field. And the scattered field contains a lot of information about target, about the geometry of target, and the material composition of the target. So as a result, if we can compute the scattered field, okay, we know the signature or fingerprint of the target. However, this computation is very challenging because at X band, it requires handling of millions of unknowns. And that's what people did about 20 years ago by Professor Chu. And that time with the development of fast algorithm, fast multiple methods, they were able to handle problems on the order of a couple of millions. And today, several groups, including a group in Berkeley University, are able to handle problems on the order of billions of unknowns, right? And with a scattered field, right, you can extract whatever, by static radar cross-section or monostatic radar cross-section, and you can also extract range profiles or psi images to characterize each individual target, right? So this is a typical defense application, and a technology heavily depends on this application is a stealth technology, right? And the reason I always like to show this application is it shows the advancement, the progress of computational EM. And this was the first stealth airplane, F-170. Developed in US, and this airplane was designed based on physical optics, and that's why you see the exterior surface of the airplane is just flat panels, simply to facilitate the application of physical optics, right? And with the progress of numerical method, later on people were able to use moment method to analyze two-dimensional object. So as with that ability, people developed the second generation of stealth airplane, which is a B-2 by Northrop Grumman. And if you look at this geometry, right, and you see most parts of this airplane can be analyzed either as a plate or as a 2D, you know, approximation, right? And then with the further progress of computational electromagnetics, people were able to handle more and more complicated geometry. And when we come to F22, now you see that geometry is much, much more complicated than V2 or F170, right? And this shows fairly clear the progress of computational EM in handling the geometry and the material composition of man-made targets. And the same thing happens in F-35, originally known as GSF, right? And if you look at this airplane, right? The geometry has almost no differentiation than traditional fighters, okay? And as I said, with the ability to compute the scattered field, then people can use signal processing technique to form the synthetic aperture radar image. And this image can be utilized for the target recognition purpose or target identification purpose, all right? So that's one application. And another typical application is antenna design, right? And you have seen many antenna design examples. So here I show you some relatively interesting one, okay? And in 50s and also early 60s, people discovered the phenomenon with this Lomborg lens, right? And for direct field, if the permittivity can change from 1 to 2 to the middle, according to this formula, right? Then this dielectric sphere can convert spherical wave from a point source to the plane wave on the other side of the sphere, right? And this kind of thing was completely invisible to human eyes, but with numerical method, we can see how this electromagnetic wave, the spherical wave, is gradually converted into a plane wave coming on the other side, right? And with reciprocity, we know that in this case, if we have a plane wave coming in from this side of the sphere, then this plane wave will be converted and focused on the other side of the sphere, right? And with this capability, what happens if we put a conducting cap here? If we put a conducting cap here, then we have a perfect reflector, right? To reflect power back into the original direction from any direction we covered with this cap. And this device was indeed realized a few years ago with simply three dielectric layers with constant permittivity, okay? And with cap at the end, okay? So with this relatively simple device, anything coming from 120 degrees, okay, will be reflected back. And this can be used as a good reflector, and with three this device, then you can cover the entire space. And this is what we get from the numerical simulation compared with measurement. And what you see here is from minus 60 degrees all the way to 60 degrees, you have a perfect reflection, right? Flat. Okay? And this is just a wonderful dielectric lens. And another interesting dielectric lens is that if you can make relative permittivity change from 1 on the surface to 4 in the middle, according to this formula, then a point source which produces a spherical wave will be gradually converted to a plane wave in the middle, then converted back to the spherical wave at the other end side. So you have a perfect focus, okay, or image of this source on the other side. So this numerical simulation, again, shows exactly what happens. And this so-called Maxwell fisheye is also a basis to make wide-angle lens for the photograph, right? And if our material technology can be further developed to increase relative permittivity from one to the surface to the infinity at the center, then we can make this equilibrium lens that can turn electromagnetic wave completely around and reflect back into the original direction. And if someday you can make this lens, okay, then numerical simulation tells us that you are going to have a perfect reflector for any direction of incidence, right? And of course, at this moment, right, this has not been realized yet because of limitation on the material technology, right? But if someday material technology is advanced such that you can make permittivity of any value, right, then this dielectric lens can be very useful for many, many commercial and defense applications, right? Okay. So this is a simulation of homogeneous dielectric lens. And another antenna example is corrugated horn antenna, which is made of surface with a bunch of grooves, okay? And we can adjust the width and the depth of these grooves to produce equivalent surface impedance. And when this surface impedance looks same for the electric field and magnetic field, then we can produce perfect circular polarized wave with identical radiation pattern. And this was an example that we simulated more than 20 years ago. And when we got the simulation and compared the measurement, right, the simulation was right on the top of the measurement, and I always use this example to show the power of computational EM. If we can solve Max's equations correctly and accurately, okay, you can reproduce the measured results without deviation, right? And of course, today most antennas are made of conformal antennas such as microstrip patch antennas, and with the development of fast algorithm, we can simulate not only one single antenna, but antenna arrays in one shot by considering all the coupling phenomena and all the effect of distributive network, right? And with this capability, of course, we can analyze any devices made of microstrip lines, and for the same reason, this approach can be used to analyze all the microwave integrated circuits. Okay? And in recent 20 years, another major application of computational EM is in the design of computer chips, or the PCB board and the packing. 20 years ago, if you go to Intel and you tell them that I'm looking for a job and my major is in electromagnetics, Intel will turn you away. They said, we don't need electromagnetics, we just need a circuit theory to design computer chips, right? But very quickly, when the speed of the computer chip increase, when the frequency increase, and when the size of computer chip is reduced, right? Electromagnetic coupling and isolation become very important. And from that on, Intel hired a lot of electromagnetic engineers to deal with electromagnetic problems in the design of computer chips, right? And as I said, one most obvious application of computational EM is wireless communication, right? And all of us use cell phones, right? Okay. And if we look at wireless communication, how many electromagnetic problems we can see? Okay. When I look at this application, at least I see three typical problems, right? One is antenna design, right? And that antenna design not only has to be designed to radiate in the free space, but it also has to be designed to radiate efficiently when the headphone is held close to our human body, right? Okay. And the second application, second EM problem is EM interaction with our human body, especially our human head, right? Because all of us know that although EM radiation is relatively safe to our human body, right? But there's still some effect. And over the years, that effect might be accumulated, right? So a very important problem is to quantify that effect and also develop technology trying to reduce the exposure of our human brain to electromagnetic wave, right? And that is, these two EM problems are shown in this slide, right? And then third EM problem is wireless wave propagation. And this is actually one of the major problems in the wireless communication industry, because to achieve better coverage with a limited number of base stations, okay, we always need to optimize the location of those base stations. And the best way to optimize locations of base stations is to use electromagnetic simulation software. Okay? At a very early stage of wireless communication, Motorola did this experimentally, right? And they can put an antenna on the rooftop and then put another receiver antenna on the top of the car and try to drive along the every street of that area to measure the receiving signal. And that is extremely time consuming. And if you have a city like Ankara, right, you want to drive on every street, it may take couple of years to optimize the location of base stations, right? And with computer simulation, this can be done in matter of days or a couple of weeks, right? Okay. And of course, when we come to the design of integrated circuit in the cell phone, right? Today we also have to consider electromagnetic effect, and that could be the fourth problem or EM problem involved in wireless communication. Okay. And I'm glad that today this professor came and he taught a course on MRI, right? Okay. And MRI is one of the major EM applications in biomedical engineering. And MRI was developed in late 70s, and actually most MRI system development happened in 80s. Okay. And MRI technology was considered a revolutionary technology. Okay, in medical diagnosis area, because MRI can produce all kinds of images, not only hard tissues, but also soft tissues, by adjusting parameters involved in this phenomenon. Okay? And with an open MRI system, okay, MRI also offers possibility for interventional treatment during the process of MRI, or in other words, MRI can be utilized to guide the treatment process, to guide the surgery, okay? And this leads to a new area called interventional MRI, okay? And with this revolutionary technology, if we look at the interior system of MRI, right? And we found that actually MRI is a big electromagnetic system, okay? And the three major components of MRI is magnetic gradient coils and IF coil. And all others are less important because all others have been well developed and you can purchase them from the market. Okay? And the magnet is used to produce a very, very strong, fairly uniform static magnetic field. And the magnetic field has to be so uniform that the deviation can only be around a few parts per minute, right? And you have to utilize a good electromagnetic knowledge and a simulation tool to design such a magnet, okay? Then within the magnet, you use a set of gradient coils to produce a static magnetic field that can change as a linear function in three directions, x, y direction, right? And the design of these gradient coils also requires the electromagnetic simulation. And then inside, gradient coil, we have ice coils, which produce ice B1 field to excite protons inside the human body. And these excited protons will emit a secondary field to be received by ice coil as well. And this one, the design, is also fairly challenging because ice field, especially at high frequency, can interact with the human body and cause variation in or inhomogeneity of the field inside the human body, right? And here is just one example that we have done 25 years ago, right? And with numerical methods such as SDTD, we are able to look at the field distribution of ice coil inside the human head. And from field distribution, we can compute a specific absorption rate, which provides very important information about safety of ice coil. And then we can also compute the B1 field, okay, which provides important information on the quality of MRI images, right? Okay. Now, with the increased power of computational EM, we can handle more larger and larger electromagnetic problems. As a result, even for the photonic devices or optical devices, right? Okay, we can use numerical methods to solve mass equations directly to provide detailed information about these devices. And these were completely unthinkable 10 years ago, because even the photonic devices are very, very small in physical size, right? They are very large in terms of wavelengths. So if we want to use numerical methods to solve this problem, this kind of analysis often results in millions or sometimes billions of unknowns. And we have to utilize powerful computers and advanced numerical methods to analyze such devices. Okay? And with that, we can simulate all kinds of electronic materials, metal materials, and also devices such as microring. Okay. And from the picture, you can see that this device is electronically extremely large. And when this device is embedded in multiple layers, and the wavelength is very small, which requires extremely small discretization elements. So electromagnetically, this represents very, very large problem. Okay? So I hope these application examples give you some sense about the application of computational EM and about current status of computational EM, right? Okay. So next, I want to give you an overview of computational EM, right? Okay. As I said, since electromagnetic phenomena are involved in many technologies, we have many, many different types of electromagnetic problems. So during the past 50 years, starting from middle of 60s, people have developed many numerical methods. Okay? So as a result, computational EM can be categorized into two big families. One is to solve max equations in the frequency domain, and the other is to solve max equations directly in the time domain, right? And these two families are covered each other through the Fourier transform, right? And as people in electromagnetics, we always know that the reason why we want to solve max equations in the frequency domain, because frequency domain max equations represent three-dimensional problem, right? Whereas time domain max equations represents four-dimensional problem. So as a result, the degree of difficulty or complexity to solve max equation in frequency domain is much reduced, right? Then inside the frequency domain depends on the size of the problem in terms of wavelengths, right? If the size is fairly large in terms of wavelengths, then we have so-called asymptotic or high-frequency methods. And these methods can be divided into two groups. One starts from geometry optics, and go to geometrical theory of diffraction, GTD, and uniform theory of diffraction, right? And this group of methods were developed by people in US, right? And another group of centroid methods starts from physical optics, right? And the improved version is physical theory of diffraction. And this was developed in Soviet Union, right? Before it was dissolved a few years ago. And as I said, US F-117 was actually designed based on physical optics instead of geometrical optics or GTD, right? Okay. Now, when the size of the problem is compatible with wavelength, or when we want to have very, very accurate solution, that accuracy cannot be afforded with asymptotic methods, then we have to solve master equations directly. And these methods are called the first principle based numerical methods. And within this family, we can solve master equations directly as partial differential equation using either finite difference method or finite element method. And today, the finite element method is dominant method because finite difference method offers no advantage at all in the frequency domain to solve Maxwell equations, right? Okay. And now if we convert partial differential equation into integral equations using Green's function, then we have moment method. And because moment method produces a fully proportionate matrix, right? Then people develop a whole set of fast algorithms to handle moment method matrix. And we have early CGFFT, which has a lot of limitations. And to remove those limitations, people develop the adaptive integral method, fast multiple method, or even better, multi-level fast multiple algorithm. And later on, people also developed this adaptive close approximation method to solve moment method matrix equations directly. Okay? So these are the fast algorithms that can be used to speed up moment method matrix solution. Okay? So in the time domain, the most popular method is FDTD, right? Everybody loves FDTD because FDTD is very simple, very powerful, and we can learn it within a matter of few days and very quickly write a computer code to get an approximate solution to understand the physical phenomenon, right? So because FDTD does not involve solution of linear algebraic equation, right? So this method is most efficient. So in the time domain, opposite to the frequency domain, FDTD, finite difference method, is much more popular than finite element method. Okay? However, in order to model geometry more accurately, people in recent years developed a finite element time domain method, or even better, the discontinuous grating time domain method. Okay? So if your research is in the computational EM and you want to look for some new direction to go, DGTD is one of good methods. It's relatively young, and it's actually much simpler method than finite element method, and it offers much better potential in terms of parallel computation and also in terms of handling multi-scale problems. Alright? Okay. And when for problems that none of these new methods are superior to other methods, then we can combine these numeric methods together to form so-called hybrid techniques that allow us to take advantage of different numeric methods and discard their disadvantages, okay, for better, more efficient solution. And also with a domain decomposition approach, okay, we can effectively parallelize these numeric methods on a parallel computer system to fully utilize parallel CPU system or even GPU systems, all right? And now with development of these numeric methods, when we look at the status of computational EM, I can pretty much say that computational EM is a relatively mature area, all right? For most pure EM problems, We not only know how to solve these problems numerically, we also know how to solve them efficiently and accurately. Okay? So as a result, during the past 10 years, many people are thinking about the question, what's the future direction of computational EM? Okay? And through various exploration, people converged into two directions. Okay? One is multi-scale challenge, okay? Because many EM problems involving structures which are sub-wavelengths in size, and at the same time other structures which are multiple wavelengths. And when these two structures coexist with each other and have to be modeled with a single numerical method, right? We can have discretization on one part, which is several orders of magnitude smaller than discretization on the other part. With this kind of numerical discretization, how to get a solution efficiently and accurately becomes fairly challenging. Right? Okay. So people try to develop methods to handle multi-scale problems. And one of the methods I mentioned is discontinuous grating time domain method. Right? Okay. And another challenge for the future research is multi-physics challenge. Okay? And tomorrow I'm going to give my second talk in Birke University to talk about multi-physics challenge. It's specially focused, and that is for the graduate level. Okay? Because in reality, for many practical engineering applications, electromagnetic phenomena just does not exist alone. It is always coupled into other physical phenomena, right? For example, EM in most devices is coupled to the thermal phenomena. And for the electronic device, high power, microwave device, and accelerator center, electromagnetic field is also coupled to the electronic particles, right? Okay, so how to handle electromagnetic interaction with particle is also a fairly interesting and fairly difficult problem. And EM is also coupled to the mechanical problems such as pressure, and acoustic problems such as acoustic violations. And if we want to get into the nanoscale, then EM can be coupled to the quantum physics, okay, for nano electronic devices. Okay? So these multi-scale, multi-physics challenges, okay, provide CEM researchers with a lot of opportunities, a lot of problems to work in the next 10, 20 years. And that's great news, and because that keeps us employed, right? And that also makes application of electromagnetics important in many other areas, okay? Even though, as I said at the beginning, electromagnetic theory is not a popular area in US, but actually job market for the electromagnetic graduates is very good. All of our students can find a job, very good job, very easily, even before they graduate. And I heard that situation is probably similar in Turkey. So good luck to all of you, and I hope you find your enjoyment in the study of electromagnetics, right? Okay. That concludes my talk.